at my father's CT scan. So this is his first one. And for those of you, and I've reversed this, so this is left and this is right. Normally CT scans and MRIs are reversed, but I wanted to show this to my siblings. And if you see something on the left, you've got to think it's on the left. So the MRIs and CT scans are all flipped. So I flipped the image so that they could see it kind of as you intuitively view it. I'm going to do some very bad art here. The midline of the brain should be at the midline. It's all the way over here. And it should be down the middle. This is about a 2 centimeter deviation to the right. And this kind of half a wing of a butterfly should have another one over here. So we're missing the ventricles, the fluid-filled cavities on the left side. They've been squished. Additionally, on the right side, you can see the gyri, the bulges, and the sulci, the dips. And these are more normal. The brain normally has curvature and dips in between. On the left side, everything is squished flat by the pressure. The amount of volume that's in this is just about like having a fist size volume stuck inside of your head. You can imagine putting a hand underneath the skull on that side and occupying this much area. So he had fallen about Thanksgiving. You know, I grew up in Fargo and it gets a little slippery back there about that time of year, icy. And he got out of the car and whoopsie-doo, kablunk, down onto the ground. And he's in his early 80s. And, you know, he hurt his arm and they went to the hospital. They got a nice hospital system in Fargo and they x-rayed his arm because they thought he might hurt that. And they stitched up his eyebrow because he had hit his head. But they didn't CT his head, which is actually a mistake. If you're a kid and you have a little nick, big deal generally. But as a senior, your brain has atrophied normally. The normal senior brain atrophies some. So it's got a little more room to flop around. And when you fall and stop your skull suddenly, the brain can bounce around in there and tear a vessel. So bleeds in brains on seniors with falls are very common, much more common. So this gigantic pool of blood over on the side here had accumulated over 5 weeks. And during that 5 week period, he was having some difficulty with speech. But, you know, he's in his 80s and, he's like a lot of males, you know, you don't want to be the zebra that sticks out in the flock or they're going to get you. So, I'm fine. You know, I called him on the phone near Christmas time and he fell near Thanksgiving, this weeks later. And he couldn't really fully understand me. He could kind of, but not really. And he couldn't speak well. He couldn't find words. And, you know, he was very verbally fluent in his day. So it was really striking to me. And at first I thought, oh, he's got a stroke. And then I know it's not behaving like a stroke. And then I thought, oh my God, he fell in Thanksgiving. This has to be a slow growing subdural hematoma. And I wrote an email and I told my dad to put my mom on the phone. I told her to print the email and take him straight to the hospital because I thought he had a bleed in his brain. And about an hour and a half or so later, I get a phone call from my mom and she says, this is the phone number. The doctor wants to speak to you. I call him. on, and they patch me through to his headset. He's in surgery, and in the surgery, basically he's draining out the 160 cc's of blood, and that's a lot of volume. Once it was drained out, basically they had to drill two holes, one further forward, one further back. And yeah, you know, it's shaved half of his head, which was quite a fashion statement for somebody in his 80s, you know, white hair on one side and shaved on the other, you know, Hollywood, you know. The next day they did a CT scan and it was starting to fill back up. He had 60 cc's or so that had filled back in. And so he said, we've got to put in a shunt to drain the blood from the head down into the abdomen. Like a VP shunt for the ventricles, only this is a hematoma shunt. It's a big fat tube. So they put the shunt in and they wheeled him down. They do a CT scan afterwards to show the shunt placement and everything. And at this point, the doctor is getting the CT scans dispatched to his office electronically and has them dispatched to me at the same exact time. So I get this this CT scan of supposedly the shunt being having been placed. I'm scanning up and down and back and forth through the brain, expecting to see either a circle because the slice would go through it, or a longer piece because it might go along it. But I don't see the shunt. And there's a CT of the entire body, and I see the entire shunt is down in his abdomen. The phone rings about the same moment as the neurosurgeon, and I said, the shunt's in his belly. And the neurosurgeon says, I know, I can't believe it, you know. We'll go in tomorrow, and we'll put it, you know, back in. I don't know how this happened, you know, really sorry. But and I said, well, you know, doc, humor me. He's an old man. He doesn't need lots and lots of surgeries in his 80s. And, you know, it was a slow refill. And you had just taken out 160 something cc's and the brain had to move back into place and nothing had sealed up and you got a little bit of blood back and you drained that out. It might have sealed. We may not have to put the shunt in. And he said, well, I suppose we could wait an extra day and see. And sure enough, it wasn't filling. So he said, well, we can take the shunt out of his belly. And I said, well, leave it in unless it bothers it. So when he died at 90, he still had a shunt in his belly. So, but let's look at some of the, let me clear my bad art out of the way here. Let's look at some of the other images here. This is when the 60 cc's had come in. You could see one of the burr holes.
Oh, wow.
Through the skull. And you can see that the cortex is starting to get the gyri and sulci back. And the midline is still a little screwy, but it's got a little bit of something off to the side here.
The ventricle's back, coming back too.
Yeah.
A little.
Now, I think this was written up in a journal. There you see half a head of hair. this is his surgical intervention at those two locations.
God damn.
And what really upset him most is that it took him away from Sunday football. and he was reluctant to go to the hospital Saturday night because, you know, if something was discovered, it would goof up Sunday football. So he still had his priorities. Anyway, the images were professionally published within a journal. The article is called Serendipity and the Subdural Hematoma, because we found it by accident, basically.